something we wouldn't accept today, but this was a long time ago and a very different culture. And this is them struggling to survive. And then it follows the story of their life. And it's interesting. But then the oldest son wins a prize in school and so on. And then the oldest son falls sick. And so the father has to go on the road and get a doctor, and the doctor doesn't want to come, and you know, because these people are very poor. But finally the doctor comes in his car and he leaves the car by the road, and he has to get in the rowboat. Father has to row, and he tries to, the doctor comes and has to climb up the mountain with them and so on and help the son, but it doesn't work, and the oldest son dies. And then there's the scene where the children from the school that they go to all come in a motorboat to the son's funeral because they're going to cremate him. That's what they do. And I'll never forget this indelible image of the motorboat as the children are leaving to go back to the mainland with the teacher and so on. And you see the boat. And you see this column of smoke over there from the top of, from the mountain over the sea. It's an incredible image. And then the next day, they go back to what they were doing. They go back to, because they have to survive. So the husband and wife go back to the, they take off their nice clothes they use for the morning, they go back to their work clothes, and they go back down, they get the water from the ditch and rows back. They go back up and they start working on the land. And all of a sudden the woman stops. And she can't go on anymore. And she walks over and she kicks over one of the water jugs. And she kicks over the other one. And she goes and starts ripping the plants out of the earth. And then she turns to face her husband defiantly. What is he going to do to her? And he looks at her, and you can see on his face that he is suffering just as much as she is. From the horrible loss. And finally, he turns and he bends over and he goes back to work. And she watches him working on the plants and taking whatever was left of the spilled water and putting it on his head. And then finally she goes back to work too. It is a brilliant, heart-wrenching film without one word of dialogue. It's revelation. The point of this story is that movies, teleplays, are visual mediums, and that what you see is what matters. And that is how you write it. So now, Alfred Hitchcock once said, to make a great movie, you need three things. The script, and the script. Now my first job in Hollywood was I worked as a reader, which means I read scripts, for the legendary Oscar-winning screenwriter-producer Ben Hay. And there's no way to even list how many, you know, but he won Underworld, Front Page, Scarface, 20th Century, Viva Villa, Barbary Coast, Nothing Sacred, Gunga Din, Wuthering Heights, Monkey Business, The Marx Brothers, It's a Wonderful World, Mutiny on the Bounty, Shop Around the Corner, Gone with the Wind, and two of Alfred Hitchcock's classics that he wrote, Spellbound and Notorious, both with Ingmar Bergman. The last one famous, the longest on-screen kiss in history between Ingmar Bergman and Cary Grant. And working for Ben, I learned three things. Because he taught me a lot, but it boiled down to three main things. Number one, I learned what makes a good screenplay. What makes a good property, what makes a good screenplay. Number two, I learned what producers look for in a screenplay. It's not the same. You can have a very good screenplay that simply produces and say, I love this, but I can't do it, or it's not for me. For a lot of reasons. It could be because there are things in it that will cost too much, because it doesn't quite hit the quadrants of demographics they're looking for, and so on. The third thing I learned is that good scripts are really hard to find. Now, you may think, Jesus, that's not possible. Everybody's throwing scripts at people. You've got agents throwing scripts at production companies and studios, hundreds every single day, every day. And these are coming from professionals. And with all that, I tell you, you're lucky if you can find one in 200 or 300 that's really worth doing. Because even the professionals make a lot of the mistakes that I'm going to teach you not to make today. So, I mean, go into any Starbucks, and I have to tell you, you're going to see people working on scripts. And I have to tell you, any Starbucks in LA, certainly, and 999 out of 1,000 screenplays being worked on aren't worth the time to read the first 5 pages. That's God's truth. And that's about as much as any professional reader, by the way, will read, unless yours has two things. Number one, the setup, which is the first 10 pages of the screenplay, the setup and the idea behind it is really compelling. And number two, the writing is professional. That is, it follows the guidelines. By guys, I don't mean formatting. I'm not going to teach formatting that I'm going to talk about today. So the first thing we're going to do is redefine how we think about movies. And here's the, and I hope you're taking notes because there's a lot to cover. There's a new way I want you to define a movie that I want you to think about. And that is a movie or a dramatic teleplay, particularly one that's done, that involves any kind of action or outdoors, not a sitcom, just people sitting in a room, is an external visual representation of the protagonist's inner journey with the boring bits left out. I'm going to repeat that again. An external visual representation of the protagonist's inner journey with the boring bits left out. And if you understand this, you'll be able to start to do visual storytelling. Now, let's look at that first phrase, external visual representation of the protagonist in a journey. Now, right now on PBS, they're showing a documentary about Steven Spielberg called Spielberg. How many of you have seen that? If you have not seen it, it's on PBS.
HBO.
And HBO, and I highly recommend it. It's very, very good and very informative. Now, in that, Spielberg himself talks about his journey. And when he says that when he was 12 years old, I mean, he'd already been, you know, kind of fooling around with cameras and stuff, but it was just one of, he was only a 12-year-old. He saw a movie, Lawrence of Arabia, the David Lee movie. It was written by David Lee. I assume everybody's seen it. Is there anybody who hasn't seen it? Good. It was directed by David Lee, and it was written by two of the greatest screenwriters who ever lived, Robert Bolt and Michael Wilson. This Michael Wilson, by the way, is not the same Michael Wilson as the one who does James Bond with his sister, Barbara Broccoli, and whom I work with, both of them. And the thing about, but this Michael Wilson had actually been a screenwriter who was on the Hollywood blacklist. Because I think he had been a communist in the 30s or something, or briefly flirted with the Communist Party, I'm not sure. But in any case, he was a brilliant screenwriter. He worked with David Lean on Bridge Over the River Kwai and on Lawrence. I personally think Lawrence is maybe the greatest movie ever made. Now, when Spielberg saw it, he was thunderstruck. And it hit him so much that he went to see it a couple of days later. He went to see it again. And then he went to see it again. And to this day, Steven Spielberg says that at least one or two times a year, he will run and see that movie, Lawrence of Arabia. And he talks about one thing in it. That he, when he first became aware of the protagonist's inner journey and how it could be represented visually through two scenes. And one scene is the one where Lawrence gets his white rose from his Arab colleagues. And he puts on the robes and he rides his camel off, and then he's off by himself in the desert. And he starts running up and back to kind of feel how it feels. He's been in an army uniform all this time. And this is a very different way of dressing and living. These robes are white. And then he takes out a dagger, because they all have a ceremonial dagger. And he holds the dagger up like a woman would hold up a mirror. To fix his headdress, you see, his kafia. Then, near the end of the movie, his face, and this is right after a battle, and Lawrence, a battle against the Turks, and now it's twilight, and Lawrence is covered in blood in the battle. And his knife is covered in blood and gore. And he holds up the knife again to look at himself, to see what he, and because that look reveals to him suddenly what he's become. Character's inner journey, done without one word. Dialogue. Two shots. One when he's looking at and everything's clean and pristine, and the second near the end of the movie when he's covered in blood that he initiated this battle. It was an unnecessary battle, but he went and initiated it anyway. The This is whose heed will come now. Here, and that just struck Spielberg so strongly, he suddenly realized this is the way you tell a story visually in movies. Now, the great 19th century French writer Stendhal defined the novel as a mirror carried along a road. Now, why a mirror? Why not, say, a telescope or something? The mirror is because the mirror, as you walk along the road, will reflect the road, the people on the road, the landscape, and the protagonist who's carrying it will see himself or herself. Now, the building blocks, the material we use to build a novel, are words. And that we use that, but novels, for stage plays are built with words. Even 1-3 camera TV indoor teleplays are built with words. But the bricks, the material that we use to build an outdoor teleplay, an action teleplay, or a movie, it's not words, it's images. Now we may use words to say what those images are. And I'm not talking about camera shot, please understand. I'm talking about what the audience sees that reveals the protagonist in a journey to them. Now for the second part of that definition, the boring bits. I hope everybody remembers Billy Wilder's classic movie, Some Like It Hot. Great. And I have a close friend, John Reilly, was very good friend. He's writing a book right now about stories about Billy Wilder that nobody else knows. But and we learned talking to people who knew Billy and Izzy Diamond and so on that everybody had different stories. So it's amazing. Billy Wilder's a wild guy. So now in the movie Some Like It Hot, there is a transition moment when Jack Lemmon and Tony Curtis, remember, here's the situation. Jack Lemmon and Tony Curtis have witnessed the gangland rubout. Now the gang wants to kill them because they're witnesses. So they decide to hide out by dressing up and pretending to be women and playing in a women's band that's going on tour to Florida. That's the Some Like It Hot, blah, blah. And so, in desperation, they decide to take this gig with the all-women band. Now, there is a scene where they decide to do that, where they say, hey, the only way we're going to, we've got this potential, they have a gig, but it's for women, men can't do it. Well, let's pretend to be women, and we'll do it. And so they're talking about, gals, we know some gals will help us get some clothes, and we'll go do it. Now, we could have had scenes of preparation. Billy Wilder and Izzy Diamond, who wrote it, could have written scenes where they were getting ready, and it could have been some stuff that was funny, I could just see Jack Lemmon saying, putting on lipstick, saying, is this my shade? And Tony Curtis saying, don't be an idiot, or something like that. But we don't have any of that. What happens is they're talking about doing it, saying, hey, we got to get out of here, and there's this gig with this woman that we'll get the clothes from the gals and put on some makeup and stuff. And the next scene, the very next instant, we see them already dressed up as women, walking on the train platform to join the women's band, and that's when we first see Marilyn Monroe coming along, because she's also late getting to the train. the entire preparation, everything about them figuring out how to do their wigs, their makeup, their changing into the women's clothes, how they get to the train station, none of that is in there. Why? Because it's boring. And it's unnecessary. The audience doesn't care. They said they were going to dress up as women, now they're women. And now they're walking on the train station. You see, Marilyn Monroe realized they can never walk like her. But be that as it may, they're going to pretend to be women. And everything about the transition has been omitted. All right, I'm going to say one thing about formatting and not mention it again. Every script that's ever been written consists of, I know we have lots of different elements and we've talked about them before, but they consist really of three main elements. And there's lots more of odds and ends like transitions, subheaders, instructions like angles, SFX for sound effects, OS for off-screen, so on and so forth. But basically, there's three elements. There's the slug line, the action paragraph, and dialogue. Now, the slug line is simply, it tells you whether you're interior or exterior, you're inside or outside. So it'll say EXT period, exterior means you're outside. INT period means you're inside. Slug line's capitalized. Secondly, it tells you where you are, John's house. And thirdly, there's a dash and it'll tell you what time of day it is. The sea, where there's nothing, is a metaphor for the edge of life. You're at the edge. Everything about it is designed to be abstract, to let us understand that Block is alone in his game with death. Another example, when you go back to Lawrence of Arabia, is the desert itself. Now the desert is both an unforgiving obstacle. The desert is its sand and rock. And it throws you back upon yourself. So it's unforgiving. It's also the object of Lawrence's quest. He goes there deliberately. He goes to the heart of the Arabian desert deliberately. So let's remember who Lawrence is. Lawrence, as we've learned, as we've gone through this, is the unrecognized bastard son of a British lord and some low-class woman that he had sex with. So the Lawrence's quest into the desert is an external visual representation of his inner journey to find out where he belongs. The desert both attracts and repels. And the third example I'm going to give is the Francis Ford Coppola movie, Apocalypse Now. Now, Coppola redefines the insanity of the Vietnam War by using the jungle landscape purely as a metaphor for it is the backdrop of Captain Willard, who's played by Martin Sheen, and he's on a journey upriver. That journey is both a metaphor for his inner journey, as well as a journey, and he's not journeying just through space, he's also journeying in time, because as he journeys, he's going back to earlier and earlier, to more of our primitive roots. His journey will literally take him back to the Stone Age. And humanity's earliest savagery. It is also a metaphor for the sheer insanity of the Vietnam War, with napalm bombings of jungle. He's just bombing trees. Of a bridge being lit up at night, being attacked by both sides with no office, all the officers have been killed. There's no purpose to this fight. There's just two sides fighting, the Americans and Barman versus the Viet Cong. And when Willard finally asks the grunt, who's in command, the grunt says, you are, sir. You get a USO complete with sexy Playboy bunnies in the middle of the Mekong Delta. It is so jarring, so you're juxtaposing things that so do not belong together. And the show is being watched by the Viet Cong until they attack the show. This is complete and total insanity, which is in fact a metaphor for Willard's quest to find Colonel Kurtz, as well as a metaphor for the insanity and logic of the war itself. Now, my next topic, Dharma Lionsgate. And this is critical, because I've seen so many scripts that screw up on this, I can't say. And movies too, where they may start out well and interesting, and then, and you walk in there, you start to lose interest. The suspense is not being sustained. So how do you sustain suspense? That's right. And the way you sustain suspense is to pose a question or a ticking bomb situation. And if possible, don't resolve it in the scene as posed. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. Better if you don't, you can still retain that tension onto the next scene and so on. I'll talk a little more about that. Now, for example, as the example I'm going to give is the 2007 movie, No Country for Old Men, which was written and directed by the Coen brothers. Great movie. Until the end. We'll talk about endings. So let me set up this scene. The setup is that there's a vicious, possibly psychotic killer. His name is Anton Chigurh. So we're just going to call him Chigurh, played by Javier Bardem, if you remember the movie. Now, we've already seen him brutally murder people. He's possibly psychotic. He escapes from the law. He takes the guy's car that he just killed with this kind of compressed air tank gun thing that blows holes. He just takes his car. And the next thing we see, he stops for gas. And the following scene, now, stopping for gas, why should that sustain suspense? Really? Why should that be suspenseful? Well, because we're not only dealing with the plot, we're dealing with the characters. What is their hidden agenda? What is their journey? And Chigurh, and everybody has an agenda and a journey, including a psychotic killer. People are not cardboard. They do not have one or two dimensions. People are real and they're very complex. Everyone, every single human you meet, every single one. So now here's the scene. We've just seen him brutally murder people. He's taken some guy's car that he's just brutally murdered this thing. And now he stops for gas at this, somewhere in the middle of God knows where, Texas. You know, shit kicker Texas somewhere. Out in the middle of nowhere. So here's the slug line. Gas station / grocery, Sheffield. That's the slug line. Okay? We already know we're outside. We already know it's daytime from previous scenes, so we don't have to put that there. Now here's the action paragraph. At an isolated, dusty crossroad. Period. You don't need complete sentences. You just need to let people know where you are. It is twilight. The Ford sedan that Chigger stopped is parked alongside the pump. And he throws in a sub. So instead of going to another scene, he just throws in a subhead, and the subhead is inside. Now he could say inside the drugstore, this guy so-and-so, who was married, just the one word, inside. We're inside a drugstore. Does he describe the drugstore? No, not a word about it. We don't care. We've been in a million drugstores in the middle of nowhere. Who cares? The boring bits. Inside, Chigger stands at the counter across from the elderly proprietor. He holds up a bag of cashews. Okay? He's a picked out bag of cashews. Following dialogue, now remember, what we're dealing with is suspense. How do we sustain suspense? In fact, why is this scene even in there? It's a classic scene. And the scene is in there to help us understand we know he's a killer, but how, what makes him different? We're about to find out. The following dialogue, all right, so Chigger stands at the counter, across from the elderly proprietor, guy behind the counter, holds up a bag of cash. Chigger, how much? Proprietor, 69 cents. Chigger, this and the gas. Proprietor, y'all getting any rain up your way? Chigger, what way would that be? Proprietor, I seen you was from Dallas. Chigger tears open the bag of cashews, pours a few into his hand. That's the actual paragraph. Chigger, what business is it of yours where I'm from? Friendo. Proprietor, I didn't mean nothing by it. Chigger, didn't mean nothing. Proprietor, I was just passing the time. Chigger, I guess that passes for manners in your cracker view of things. Feet. Proprietor, well, sir, I apologize. If you don't want to accept that, I don't know. If you don't want to accept that, I don't know what else I can do for you. Chigger stands chewing cashews, staring while the old man works the register. Will there be something else? Chigger, I don't know. Will there be? Now, I didn't want to do this whole scene because it's actually fairly long. But the scene develops in this dialogue to where Chigger takes out a quarter and asks the guy to call him. The proprietor says, well, I don't want to do that. He's already been made very nervous by this guy. He's scared of this guy, clearly. And wouldn't you be? Because this guy won't let anything go. And Chigger says to him, and the proprietor says, well, I'm not, I don't want to do that. He says, no, you, he says, you're getting, you know, you need to call us. He's going to insist on him calling you. The guy says, well, I can't call someone unless we know what we're betting for. And Chigger says, everything. So we now know that if the guy calls the coin wrong, heads or tails, Chigger will kill him. And Chigger looks at the coin and says, 1958. He realizes the coin's been traveling for 27 years till it winds up in this place at this time. This is really something. This coin has made it here. And he makes him call it. And the guy finally, he flips the coin, he calls it, and the guy says, yes. And Chigger said, well, this is your lucky day. He said, gives him the coin, gives him the quarter, says, you keep that quarter. You don't mix it in your pocket with the other quarters. That is your lucky quarter, friend. Now, this is a scene that sustains suspense, doesn't it? It It's just a guy buying cashews. What it tells us, it, so why is it in this, why is it here? And how does it, it sustains suspense because it reveals the character of the murderer. And we realize he will kill anyone, anyone who crosses some kind of invisible line that he's got of propriety that he will not allow. And if you cross that line, however inadvertently, he will murder you. And he lives by that. And that sustains suspense. Remember, when you're writing, oh, you always want to sustain suspense. You always want the audience wondering what's going to happen next, not what's happening. The audience should not wonder about what's happening in front of them. The audience, and with Chigger standing with the proprietor, would say, oh my God, what's gonna happen? Is he gonna kill him or isn't he? What's going to happen next? That's how you sustain suspense. You pose a dangerous situation, and danger can be emotional. It doesn't have to be me murdering somebody. It can be me, you know, like a wife who wants to leave her husband or something. It can be emotional. But you pose the question, you pose the ticking bomb, you pose the situation that is dangerous, not just for the physical, but perhaps the emotional well-being of somebody. And you have suspense. And you don't answer it, you sustain it. Now, next thing you need is to understand the story you're telling. I can't tell you how many writers do not understand their own stories. It's unbelievable. You need to understand what story you're telling, the story construct, and it, the image as metaphor. Now, Robert McKee says, who's like a screenwriting guru, and he says, if the story you're telling is the story you're telling, you're in deep shit. Now, this is sort of comparable to what I was talking about in dialogue, when it's a dialogue that's too on the nose, a dialogue that lacks subtext. It is the subtext of the entire story that is the real story. In other words, there's the story you're telling, and then there's the story you're really telling. And examples of this can be seen in three very interesting war movies. Now, the first, we'll go back to Casablanca. Now, on the surface, the story that the Epstein brothers and director Mike Curtis are telling is a love triangle. Who gets Ilsa? Humphrey Bogart's Rick or Paul Henri's Victor Laszlo? That's the story they're telling. But that's not what Rick's journey is about. Rick's journey is really about what does a human being owe his society? What poet Robinson Jeffers called birth dues. It's a great phrase, birth dues. It's what we owe for being born. Now, Casablanca is a war movie. It was made in 1942 during the middle of World War II. That's what gives it resonance. What makes it extraordinary, think, is that it's one of the great war movies without showing a single soldier or battle or explosion. There's none of that. Yeah, there are some people in uniform, but they're really sort of Gestapo or policemen rather than soldiers. Not walking around with rifles conquering things. So the movie is really all about Rick's journey, his quest for Ilsa, and whether he owes it. Because let's remember, Rick's line when Peter Lorre asks him to save him is, I stick my neck out for no one. He has disengaged. He's a loner. As far as he's concerned, society can go to hell. So what it's his journey to his posterity, to whether he's going to rejoin the fight, in this case, against the Nazis, portrayed by Major Strauss of the Gestapo. That's the real story. But that's not the story the Epsteins write. They're writing about the triangle. But underneath, that's Rick's real journey. That's one of the things that makes that movie work. Because the story you're telling should not be the story you're really telling. Now, let's look at Apocalypse Now. Francis Ford Coppola directed, John Milius wrote the screenplay. And you might know from Jeremiah Johnson and some other things. Now, Captain Willard's journey upriver is to assassinate Colonel Kurtz. That's the story that John Milius and Francis Ford Coppola are telling. That's it. He's going upriver, gonna kill Kurtz. That's his assignment. But the protagonist in a journey takes him through the war. So that's the story that Coppola and Milius are telling us. They're saying, hey, Wallace is, but he's really going through the war. It's a journey, as we said before, not just in space, but in time. Willard is going back in time to mankind's primitive beginnings. When he finally comes to Kurtz, he sees Kurtz's kingdom of naked painted bodies, of ritualistic slaughter of men and animals, of human heads displayed like trophies. And he realizes mankind here with Kurtz has returned to our pure Stone Age origins. And he's revealing us human beings for who we are, and that is savages. Now this war for Colonel Kilmore, played by Robert Duvall, he sees it as a game. Loves the smell of napalm in the morning. He wants these guys to go surfing on the fire. That's a mirror for us to look at. Remember the mirror. And realize that we have never left our savage origins behind. Vietnam is a funhouse mirror that forces Willard, by an extension us, to see that civilization is beneath it. And cutting off heads is simply the logical extension of Willard's journey. Now that's the story that Coppola and John Milius are telling based on the original novel, Heart of Darkness, by Joseph Conrad, which was about Africa. The second movie, where we talk about the story we're telling and then the story we're really telling, is Saving Private Ryan, Steven Spielberg's 1998 movie, for which he won Best Directing Oscar. And I think it all, and the screenplay was by Robert Rogan. Now this movie, the opening is in a cemetery in Normandy. And we get the image of an older man come to visit lots of crosses. And he's walking in these crosses and he stops. And then we cut to D-Day, the famous D-Day scene. All shot virtually without a single word of dialogue. It's just a little bit. It lasts a long time, maybe 20 minutes. And here we see the reality of the war as it was experienced on Omaha Beach. Indeed, they have an American soldier with Tom Hanks as Captain Miller. Now, let's think about this for a second. Is this story about the tragedy of war? I mean, everyone dies. I mean, a lot, everyone dies. scheme of human history, why does it matter? Is it because they're Americans? I mean, suppose you find a cemetery, you know, somebody's digging up an archaeological dig in Rome and they find ancient graves down there. Does anybody care about the people we pick up? Even though some of them might be ancestors of some of us sitting here. We might have some DNA from one of these bones they pull out of the ground. We don't care. So what makes this important? What is this story really about? Well, part of it is it moral to risk an eight-man squad, to risk eight men to save one? Why? Why are we doing this? Is it because Ryan's mother, who's lost her three other sons, has suffered so grievously because of the loss of them? So is one woman's grief what the war is about? I mean, isn't the war against the Nazis a war we had to fight? So what's the problem here? Unless Spielberg is asking a much bigger question. Why are we here? What is the real value of human life? And if we ask that, then by extension, we're asking, what is the value of a single human life? At one point, Captain Miller has to organize a squad of soldiers to go out and find and risk and get this Private Ryan so they can send him home. But at one point, Captain Miller hopes that this Ryan, whoever he is, because I haven't found him yet, will do something important, you know, cure cancer or something. When the movie ends, Ryan himself, now a much older man, now has to confront the real question Spielberg's asking. So he says to his wife something more important. Am I a good man? What he's really asking is, what is a man? What's a human being? What's a worthwhile human, and am I one? These men died to save me. Was their sacrifice worth it? Was Captain Miller's life, and during the course of the movie, when Captain Miller was a teacher before he went into the army, was his life valuable to children? Was his life worth spending to save Ryan? But the story Steven Spielberg is telling isn't just about the squad going to find or bring home a single soldier. In other words, what makes the movie work is he's not telling the story he's really telling. Go back to what Robin McKee said, if the story you're telling is the story you're telling, you're in deep shit. So there should be the surface story and then the real story. And without the two, the surface story lacks resonance. Now, the one flaw in it is that he uses dialogue to do it, which is exactly the thing we said, don't do it. And that's because Steven Spielberg has a sentimental streak. And that's a flaw in an otherwise brilliant movie. And I'll talk about that when we talk about endings. But now, let's move on to a different topic. The next topic is building a climactic or confrontational scene. And I define six types of climax or confrontational scenes. That is the hero versus the enemy. And an example of that is Casablanca. So who's, first I'll define them all, then we'll talk about each one. The hero versus the status quo, or the powers that be. Example of that is the movie Norma Jean, starring Sally Fields from the Chamar Hospital. The hero versus the system, and an example of that is the movie Sully, starring Tom Hanks. The hero versus God, and that's Scarlett O'Hara, played by Vivian Leigh, versus God, and Gone with the Wind. The hero versus the bad guy, and an example of that is George Stevenson's Shame, screenplay by A.B. Guthrie Jr. And the hero versus himself. An example of that is the movie Steve Jobs. So let's look at each of these first, just a minute. The hero versus the enemy, Casablanca, that's really easy. I mean, the Nazis are there. You've got the Gestapo, Major Strasse. Why is it not the hero versus the Major Strasse? Because Major Strasse, if you killed Major Strasse today, they'd be replaced, you know, in 30 minutes by another Nazi equally as nasty. It's the Nazis that are the enemy. This is a war movie. And the hero, the protagonist's journey, as we said, is twofold. On the surface, it's the triangle story. But the real story is, will he rejoin the fight against who? The enemy. So the protagonist's obstacle is the enemy. The hero versus the powers of the earth, that's Norman Jean. And think of Norman Jean trying to organize this textile factory in the South. And she is one woman and she's against them. These men represent the corporation. And don't give a damn about them. Don't give a damn. They'll tell their workers anything. And at some point, Norma Jean just stops and stands on the table and holds her fist up saying, "Union." Holds a little handwritten sign saying, "Union." That is a brilliant scene. It is one woman alone. Norma Jean against the powers that be, in this case, that textile company. But what she's really standing up for is every downtrodden person on this planet fighting against the status quo. Now, that lone young woman. The hero versus the system. In Sully, we have the famous landing on the Hudson where Sully lands, Tom Hanks lands the plane on the Hudson River because he feels there's no place else to land it. When the Transportation Board starts to do, and Aeronautic Safety Administration starts to do computer simulations, they decide that the computer decides that he had enough time to be able to land it instead at an alternate airport. And now the conflict is between Sully and the system. The people who are doing it were saying to Sully, "No, you shouldn't have landed the airplane in the wrong place. No, we're going to have to take your pilot's license, basically." Even though we saved all the people. But they're the system. How do they know they're right? Well, the computer tells them. Is there anybody else in this room that feels that way? Every damn one of us. The computer knows better than us. And the computer is saying, "Sully, you did the wrong thing. You risk these people's lives for nothing." And so his conflict is between himself and the system. The people who are doing it aren't bad. They would love to see Sully proven right. He's not a bad guy. They're not bad people. They're just doing their job. The computer says so. The battle is with the system, the way the computer is being used. Have you taken other factors into account that isn't in your algorithm? And so he finds the solution. The conflict between hero and God. That's a good one. That's really a good one. And the best expression of it I've ever seen is in Gone with the Wind. And it's that moment after the Battle of Atlanta. Scarlett has taken Melanie in the car, and the darky servant and Melanie's baby, and she's somehow managed to get them back to Tara, her home plantation. All the other plantations have been burned to the ground by the Yankees. And she comes in and she discovers that, I mean, at this point, Scarlett O'Hara's is standing for Job. Because she's done all this, and she somehow managed to survive. And she comes home, because the one person that she relies on in this entire world is her mother, and discovers her mother's dead. I forget what it was, scarlet fever or something, or cholera, whatever it was, mother's dead. And her father now, so she turns from her that to her father and discovers he's lost his mind. He thinks for, you know, Confederate money's still good, or, you know, I mean, Doug bonds are still good, he doesn't understand. She has lost, and then she goes to the servants, the slaves who still stayed on the plantation, and she goes to Polk and to Mammy, and she says, okay, well, everybody's hungry, let's eat, and there's no food. There's nothing. And they're all talking to her. They want her to solve the problem. And Polk said, well, there's the radishes. The Yankees didn't find the radishes in the garden. Your mom had a vegetable garden out there. So she runs out in the back. She digs in the dirt for the radishes. And she eats one. And she hasn't eaten in such a long time, it's so harsh on her stomach, she throws up. She can't even eat a dirty, filthy radish. She is Job. She is every one of us who has been overwhelmed by something that has happened and that has taken everything. And what is Scarlett O'Hara? What is her journey? She takes the radish and she stands with her fist to the sky because the pre-dawn light is just breaking. She hopes so we can see her, and she stands, and we're seeing her from the back. Because this isn't about her, this is about us. And she holds her fist to the sky and she says, as God is my witness, I will never be hungry again. Not me, not my people. She's finding God. She's holding that radish up to God. This is a conflict between the hero, in this case, the woman, Scarlett O'Hara, and God. This is where the myth of the Confederacy arises. This is good and bad. This is her courage in standing up to what's happening. Now there's the hero versus the bad guy. And Shane is a good example of that. And in Shane, we also have an example. There's a big cattle land baron named Riker who's going to take over the farm that Gene Arthur and Van Heflin have with their little boy. Brendan Dwyer. And the enemy, very specific, the enemy is the cattle baron. And now I worked on Jacob Bonner, and so I had long discussions with the Broadways many times. And one of the things we talked about, and I kind of tried to emphasize, was that in James Bond, you always had what I called a head villain and a body villain. In other words, you know, you had Goldfinger, who was the brain, and Oddjob, you know, the Korean guy who throws his hat and chops off the tops of heads of statues, as the guy you have to fight. You can't beat him because he's so strong. Or you have Blofeld and Jaws. So Blofeld's the brain, Jaws is the body. That's the villain. You have the same thing in Shane, where Riker, the cattle baron, is the brain, Wilson, the gunfighter, played by Jack Palance, is the body villain. He's the one you have to defeat in order to defeat the brain guy. And finally, you have the hero versus self. And Steve Jobs, the movie, is a very good example of that. Here we have Steve Jobs. The movie captures him in three acts. Yeah, and each time he's introducing a new product. And so we see his progression as a person. The real conflict is he has a daughter from a woman whom he never married and separated from, and I can't remember. But the thing is, will he recognize her? Yeah, he's giving her some money and so on, but will he actually be anything resembling a father to her? And that battle is not taking place externally. That battle, like Hamlet, is taking place inside Steve Jobs. The battle is between him and himself. And finally, I want to talk about endings. I've seen a bunch of screenplays that are pretty decent. And there are movies that are just brilliant movies, and then the ending sucks. So, and that's because the vast majority of screenplays don't know how to end. Now, in the classic structure, the resolution comes after plot point two. Plot point two, you get the climax and the finale. Now, if you use the beat structure, and we've discussed both before, you get the break into three, when the solution's found, and the finale, which consists of the climax, when the bad guys or whatever issues the protagonists are dealing with are dispatched, followed by the resolution, in which we tie up all the loose ends. Now, most movies and scripts, even good ones, unfortunately, either go too long, or like Steven Spielberg, they become sentimental, or the end without a clear resolution. Now let me give you an example of going too long. Lord of the Rings, Return of the King. Now in the last of the Lord of the Rings trilogy of movies, it really is a classic example of a movie that doesn't know where to end. We have a climax, which is Frodo throws Gollum, who's holding the ring, into the volcano of Mordor. The evil Sauron's forces are destroyed. Frodo and Sam escape the volcano and are rescued by Gandalf's eagles. Now the resolution comes with Aragorn being crowned King of Gondor. He has Arwen as his queen, so we've resolved that storyline. And now everyone all bows to Frodo because they realize that he's the one that saved all of Middle-earth from Sauron. That should have been the end of the movie. But is it? Nope. So what happens? Then the hobbits return to the Shire. Sam sees Rosie in the tavern. Sam and Rosie get married. And the movie keeps going. Frodo takes ship and departs Middle-earth with Gandalf and the elves. But the movie keeps going. Frodo leaves Sam the Book of Westmarch. Sam goes home, gets a warm welcome, and finally, mercifully, the movie ends 20 minutes longer than needed. When after they acknowledge Frodo, we're done. There's nothing more to tell. Way too long. Sentimentality. We talked about Saving Private Ryan, that whole scene at the end. When the older Ryan asks his wife, am I a good man? And she and his family comfort him. Very nice, very sentimental. All's well that ends well. All the camera has to do, remember, don't do dialogue, don't do all that stuff. If what? If you can do it with a camera. All the camera has to do is start the scene where he's looking at the cross in the cemetery of crosses, thousands of crosses, because that's the lives we spent to liberate Europe. And angle the camera on the cross with the name Captain John Miller, 2nd Ranger Battalion, U.S. Army. Because the audience will know that's Tom Hanks down there. Bang. End. Because that asks the same exact question that we've been asking. What is the value of a human life? Only it's done without words or sentimentality, because this is too big for sentimentality. I repeat, never do a dialogue when you can do it with a camera. Now, what's an example of going too short or leaving things unresolved? Well, one of the same movie I read a scene from, No Country for Old Men. Now, in the climax, the guy who stole the money, Moss, played by Josh Brolin, is killed by Mexicans. Sheriff Bell, Tommy Lee Jones, who's been hunting both Moss and Sugar, played by Javier Bardem, decides to retire. Moss's wife, Carla Jean, returns from her mother's funeral to find Sugar waiting for her in her bedroom. We know what this is about. We're scared stiff for her. We know what's about to happen with Sugar. He offers her as a time cost. Wow, we've been through this in the drugstore. We know exactly what's coming. We're at the edge of our seats. She refuses his offer of a time cost, stating, it's not my choice, it's yours. She puts it right back on him. And he understands that. And so by the strange rules that he plays, he accepts that, because it forces him to look at it himself. So Chigo leaves the house, he is injured and flees. Then we go back to Tommy Lee Jones. And he's now retired. Time's passed. He shares a dream he's in bed. He's in bed with his wife, and he shares a dream he's just had, that he and his father were riding through a mountain pass, and his father had gone ahead to make a fire in the darkness to wait for him. And the movie ends. There's no resolution. We never see what happens to Chigga or see him get his comeuppance. It's very unsatisfying. It just ends. Now, I followed the book. But movies aren't books. And when we want resolution, that's the whole point. We want resolution. And there are two characters' journeys in this. One, there are three characters' journeys. in protagonist duties in this. One is the old sheriff, played by Tommy Lee Jones, Bell. One is the character who stole the money, played by Josh Brolin, Moss. But the other is Chigger. And we know, he may not be very likable, but we need to know the end of his journey too. Now, what's a perfect ending? The first Raiders of the Lost Ark, the first Indiana Jones movie. I know everybody's seen that. Now, in the climax of the movie, holy fire from the Ark engulfs the Nazis. Everyone except Indy, played by Harrison Ford, and Marion, played by Karen Allen. And they embrace it. They're alive. Everybody else is dead. So for the resolution, in Washington, D.C., Army intelligence agents informed Indy and Marcus Brody that they don't have the Ark. The Army's taking it away from them. And it's someplace safe, and it will be studied by top men. And Indy asked, Marcus asked who, and they repeat, top men. And Indy, then we see Indy and Marion walking out of some building in Washington. And Indy's complaining they don't understand what they have. Well, of course not. We've seen the power of the Ark now, and these idiots have. The final shot of the film is the crate containing the Ark. It's shown being stored in a giant government warehouse. This and that in the screenplay, they're wondering, can I work with this guy? Is this worth my time? Is he or she worth my time? Can we make something of this, or can't we? And I'm not gonna work with people I can't work with. I want you to go back, every one of you, and look at your screenplay. I want you to look at every single scene and every single word in every single scene. Because now you have the rules that will make it better. If you follow the rules I've given you, it will be a much better screenplay, I guarantee you. If it is not, if your script is not director ready and actor ready, it's not ready. Rewrite it using the guidelines I've given you. Honor the craft. Don't do it because you want to sell it. Don't do it to please some producer or director. That way hell lies, I promise you. Don't do it for anybody else. Do it for yourself, for the craft. This business of writing is damned hard work. Unless you're willing to do it, unless you're willing to write and rewrite, until it's a script that's as perfect as you can make, not just perfect as you make, but a movie that you're willing to pay 12 or 14, whatever dollars they're charging these days, unless it's that good that you're willing to pay to see it, see the movie that you're willing to want to see, not to kill time, because nobody goes to movies that way anymore. You used to go to movies to kill time. Nobody does that anymore. But because you really want to see it. So unless you're willing to do that work, stop now. Yes. You're wasting your time, wasting everybody else's time. But if you're willing to do the work, no matter what happens, wow, you'll have done it. That's the most important thing that human beings can do. Hold a mirror up to show yourself and your fellow human beings who they really are. If you get one moment like that, like in that Japanese movie, The Naked Eye, that I saw all those decades ago, I still remember vividly. Show people who they really are. It's why we told stories around fires in caves, huddled together in the darkness, because in fear of the dark of what was outside. It's what makes us human, which is something utterly unique in this vast and starry.